One of the most extraordinary aspects of the early part of the investigation into Madeleine's disappearance is that the Portuguese police never had access to the cameras of the McCanns and their Tapas 7 friends. With the benefit of hindsight, this was a significant error. But I suggest that we can excuse the Portuguese police for that, since they were organising a massive search and being hounded by the frenzied international mainstream media in what they were led to believe by the McCanns was a hunt for an abducted child. Some journalists, especially British ones, were, in that very first week, vocalising bogus concerns that the Portuguese police were not pursuing the search for Madeleine vigorously enough. In fact, they drafted in hundreds of police officers to comb the area, and local villagers spent days searching high and low for Madeleine. We now know from several sources that the McCanns and their advisers searched through their cameras and those of some of their friends, ending up by producing 2 CDs of photographs for police use. They did not hand their actual cameras or memory cards to the Portuguese police. It seems the police were too preoccupied searching for Madeleine, so there is no way of knowing for certain whether these CDs, handed to the Portuguese police on Wednesday the 9th of May, or possibly the day before, were a true record of all of the images taken on that holiday by the McCanns and their friends. However, evidence suggests that the McCann team only gave carefully selected compilations of photographs to the police. I will suggest, as we examine the evidence, that it is probable that many photographs that could have been incriminating in one way or another were deleted before these CDs were given to the police. Who compiled the CDs of photographs handed to the Portuguese police? We know now that at least 2 people helped the McCanns extract images from their camera or memory cards to prepare them to be given to either the media or on CD to the police. One was a relative of Kate McCann, Michael Wright, from Skipton, Yorkshire. Still more significant, the other person helping the McCanns was the powerful figure of Alex Woolfall, who was described in the press as Mark Warner's expert in crisis management. But he was much more than that. He was actually the head of issues and crisis management for the entire Bell Pottinger Group, the firm headed by public relations magnate Lord Bell, Lady Thatcher's former PR guru. Alex Woolfall's expertise appears to be more about rescuing the reputations of companies and individuals who are in a tight spot than in helping the search for an abducted child. His main expertise, like that of the McCann's chief PR spokesman, Clarence Mitchell, was in manipulating the media. Bell Pottinger is a company who seems to be prepared to represent anyone if the money is right. Lord Bell told author Owen Jones that the McCanns had paid his company £500,000 to keep Madeleine on the front pages of British newspapers for a year. Lord Bell was quoted as saying, "I'm not really interested in what the McCanns think. They paid me £500,000 in fees to keep them on the front page of every newspaper for 1 year, which we did." Now, the first question we might ask is, why was it necessary for 2 people, let alone one, to help the McCanns prepare images for the police and the media, when the focus, after all, was on finding Madeleine? If the police really wanted photographs, why not just hand over their memory cards to the police? There is a Portuguese police statement dated Wednesday the 9th of May, 6 days after Madeleine was reported missing, confirming that Jerry McCann had handed in to the Portuguese police at Portimão 2 CDs of photographs, one produced by him and one by his Yorkshire in-law, Michael Wright. Yet, on the very same day, a junior Hampshire police officer, Detective Constable Stuart William Martin, was examining 2 camera memory cards from an Olympus C50 camera, apparently containing valuable photographs from that week at Praia da Luz. A great mystery surrounds these 2 memory cards, which so far I've not been able to get to the bottom of. In fact, the police that day received these 2 memory cards and some video footage. These 3 exhibits were all labelled NALF, which are the initials of Hampshire resident Nigel Foster, who was on holiday with the McCanns that week in Praia da Luz. Nigel Foster is mentioned, though not by name, in Kate McCann's book, Madeleine. Let's have a look at what she says about him. This incident is said to have taken place on the same day Madeleine was reported missing. After my tennis lesson, I hung around the grassy play area, watching Jerry on the court and chatting to Russell O'Brien, who I'd found there. Another guest appeared with a video camera to record his three-year-old daughter playing mini tennis. He looked a little embarrassed and laughingly remarked to us that filming in this way made him feel like a dirty old man. It led to a conversation between the three of us about paedophiles. I remember Russell talking about how everything had got a bit out of hand, that these days people were so untrusting you hardly dared speak to children you didn't know. What he was effectively saying was that the world had become paranoid, that he wanted his daughters to grow up with confidence and a sense of freedom. The other dad, Nigel Foster, and I chipped in with our views. I mentioned not being allowed to take photographs of your own kids in swimming pools any longer. And we agreed that it was a shame things had come to this. It was just 5 days after this, Tuesday the 8th of May, that Nigel Foster took it upon himself to contact Leicestershire Police and offer his photographs from the holiday to the police. Things moved on rapidly. He was told to contact Hampshire Police. He did so, handing in not only his video footage from Pride of Luz, but also, apparently, two memory cards from an Olympus camera. From there, the police delivered these items to DC Martin's house that evening. And the following day, DC Martin had these taken into his place of work, which was the Hampshire Police high-tech unit at Netley, Hampshire, one of the foremost high-tech units in the country. Here is his statement. Videotape from Sony Handycam video camera, 64 MB memory card from Olympus C50 camera, 32 MB memory card from Olympus C50 camera. The package contained an Olympus C50 camera and a memory card holder which contained one card in the camera and one card in the memory card holder. I imaged NALF/2 using guidance software, computer forensic software called Encase version 5. I imaged NALF/3 using guidance software, computer forensic software called Encase version 5. I located 43 pictures in the live area of the two cards. Using my forensic software, I was able to locate 73 picture files in the unallocated clusters which had been deleted and were no longer accessible to the camera user. I produced a report. I produced a compact disc, SWM301944, containing the pictures, and a report, SWM301945. I have also copied the pictures and the folders they appear on the cards to the disc. On the face of it, the Olympus camera and the two memory cards would appear to belong to Nigel Foster, along with the video footage. To give it its full description, it was an Olympus Camedia C50 5-megapixel digital camera, W/3X optical zoom electronics. One reviewer pointed out one of its distinct advantages, writing, "On the positive side, pictures are fantastic. I take this camera with me everywhere and barely have to make any adjustments for my picture taking. Also, the camera allows you to rotate the pictures and crop within the camera itself. It's great to have that capability before downloading to your computer. Such a time saver." But a great deal of speculation surrounds this camera and the two memory cards. For example, this black and white photograph shows the majority of the Tapas 7 group of friends enjoying tea time together at the Paraiso Beach restaurant in Praia da Luz between 5:30 p.m. and 6 p.m. on the day Madeleine was reported missing. A Madeleine McCann researcher has been able to identify five of them. The person most likely to have taken this photo is Fiona Payne, husband of Dr. David Payne, who is known to be a keen photographer and is not in the shot. The photograph closely matches an image captured on CCTV by the restaurant owner at exactly 6:10 that afternoon. Photographs like this one could be very valuable from an evidential point of view. So what other photographs were taken on that camera that day or that week? As I'll show in a moment, we don't know what has become of all the other photos that were no doubt taken by Fiona and David Payne and by the other members of the Tapas 7 that week. So, why were the two sets of photographs being analysed by two separate police forces? Let me look in a bit more detail at what happened to the video footage on Nigel Foster's camera. On Tuesday the 8th of May, and remember, this was only the fifth day after Madeleine had been reported missing, Leicestershire Police, as this report shows, sent this email to their opposite number in Portugal. "Would you kindly permit an officer to visit Mrs. Foster? She has recently been on holiday to the Mark Warner complex and is in possession of video footage taken by her husband. It is understood that the footage is currently contained on their home computer. The allocated officer will need to review the footage, and all footage of the complex should be downloaded onto a suitable storage disk. Mr. Foster has indicated it probably only consists of a 30-second pan of the playground area / pool area / tapas bar. Mr. and Mrs. Foster are not technically competent to download the data. Please statement accordingly, re-exhibit continuity. I have spoken to Mr. Foster this morning, and he has been advised that local officers will make contact with his wife. If possible, please send a copy to me for initial viewing in the incident room." We see here that all that is mentioned is video footage lasting about 30 seconds. There is no mention, however, of a memory card, no mention of a second memory card, and certainly no mention of a camera. So that still leaves the basic question unanswered. Who did these three items belong to? We find that on these two memory cards there were also 73 deleted photographs. Now, there is nothing remarkable in that. We all delete some of our digital photographs from time to time. But what is strange is DC Martin does not mention having tried to retrieve any of these deleted images. You would have thought that in a case as important as this, a young missing child, that he would say something about recovering those images. These two memory cards were, after all, being examined at the Hampshire Police High Tech Unit in Netley. DC Martin says that he placed all the images on a disc. It appears he forwarded this disc to Leicestershire Police. One point I want to mention here, and I may develop in a later film, is the precise role of Leicestershire Police in this case. It came up in the Leveson inquiry, where one of the witnesses was Matt Baggett, the Chief Constable of Leicestershire Constabulary at the time Madeleine was reported missing. He was later promoted to run the police service of Northern Ireland. He made this remarkable disclosure to Leveson. On 8th of May 2007, Leicestershire Constabulary was asked to coordinate the UK response to assist the Portuguese inquiry on behalf of the UK Government and Association of Police Chief Officers. The gold strategy set on this date established that it was a Portuguese-led inquiry and that all actions comply with the requirements of Portuguese law, including their Judicial Secrecy Act. Due to the unprecedented media interest in the UK, a coordination group was set up on behalf of law enforcement agencies and government departments to coordinate the media interaction and ensure that a consistent stance was taken. This coordinating group was chaired by the head of corporate communications from Leicestershire Constabulary. That group has continued to meet as required since 2007. Due to the thirst for information from the media, every individual working in Leicestershire supporting the police investigation signed a confidentiality agreement. Messages were also disseminated to all staff to make them aware that even private conversations with friends could be reported on in the media. The confidentiality agreement was something that was put together by the Gold Group, who were running the inquiry as part of the UK effort, not by myself as Chief Constable. Bear in mind that if this Gold Group was established on Tuesday the 8th of May, someone at the highest possible level in the British government must have ordered this at least a day or two beforehand. At that time, Madeleine might well have been found, dead or alive, at any time. What possible urgent need was there for such an intense, high-level strategy group? And isn't the excuse of unprecedented media interest rather a feeble one for setting up this high-powered group? A similar excuse, the thirst for information from the media, was also used to gag anyone connected with the inquiry, who had to sign an unprecedented confidentiality agreement warning them that any breach of confidentiality would result in being prosecuted under the Official Secrets Act. One Madeleine McCann researcher put in an FOI request simply asking which agencies were represented on this high-level gold strategy group. The reply in October 2014 came back: "Leicestershire Police can neither confirm nor deny that it holds the information you requested, as the duty in Section 11A of the Act does not apply by virtue of the following exemptions: international relations, investigations, law enforcement. Section 27 recognises that the effective conduct of international relations depends on maintaining trust and confidence between governments. If the United Kingdom does not maintain this trust and confidence, its ability to protect and promote UK interests through international relations will be hampered, which will not be in the public interest. So, unable to even confirm or deny whether they even had information about which agencies were represented on that all-important strategy group, I would take an educated guess that government security agencies were well represented on that group. But to return to the matter of what happened to the disc of photographs that DC Martin compiled. In the Portuguese police files, we find this short report from Inspector Ricardo Paiva. I can confirm that photographs from a CD provided by Leicestershire Police were visualised and analysed. These referred to photographs taken by the Fosters family during their holiday at the Ocean Club between the 28th of April and the 5th of May 2007. Upon analysing these photos, the result was that there was at least one photograph where some of the individuals making up the group of friends of the McCann's couple were visualised, nothing relevant being found for the investigation. So, after the effort of examining two memory cards, whosoever they really belonged to, and a short video clip of 30 seconds, all that they had was one photo with some of the Tapper 7 on it. But perhaps what is of more interest is what was happening to some other photographs down in Portugal. On the very same day that DC Martin was downloading digital photographs from two memory cards from the Olympus, Jerry McCann likewise was handing in two computer discs of photographs to the Portuguese police in Portimão. And these images, apparently 113 images and dozens of duplicates, we can see in the Portuguese police files. And they are mostly, or all, from the holiday. The trouble is, the Portuguese police were not handed any original memory cards. It appears just images scanned into PDF format and then put onto a couple of CDs. Nearly all of the images appear in the files as grainy, poor quality, black and white images. Colour photographs taken by the Portuguese police which appear in the police files are reasonably clear, so why do the images provided on a CD by Jerry McCann look like this? A volunteer Portuguese translator known as Album has analysed these black and white images and made these introductory comments on them. He says there are 97 pages of images, mostly black and white silhouettes, many duplicates. Almost all of the black and white images do not readily permit identification of the individual. They were created for the PDF using what is known as black and white scanning and printing. Just three of the images were produced in both black and white and in colour, namely the three playground photographs that we have already seen. It seems odd that just these three pictures have been made available in colour. Why couldn't Jerry McCann have made them all available in colour? But the lack of colour is not the only problem in making use of these photographs. There is no information about which camera or cameras they came from. A Portuguese police officer, Ricardo Paiva, simply states the following. On this date, Tuesday the 9th of May, I state that the photographs contained on the two CDs delivered to this police force by Gerald McCann and Michael Wright have been visualised and analysed. Some of them are from the holiday period that the McCann family spent at the Ocean Club in Praia da Luz, beginning on the 28th of April 2007. The visualisation and analysis of these images that was carried out reveals that there are several photographs of interest to the investigation in which it is possible to visualise Madeleine McCann, nor are these photos accompanied by any details of the times they were taken or even the dates, information which certainly might be able to help in their detective work. Were Jerry McCann, Michael Wright and Alex Wolfel engaged in a deliberate operation to give the police as little information as possible, whilst at the same time appearing to be as helpful as possible? Elsewhere, Portuguese police inspector Hugo Ferreira states this: I am pleased to inform you that today we were given photographic stills taken during the holiday period in Portugal from the 28th of April by the English families that composed the group that Madeleine Beth McCann was with, so that they can be annexed to the process files. This statement makes the most sense. It is clear that the two CDs taken in by Jerry McCann and Michael Wright were a composite of photographs taken from maybe several cameras. Indeed, when we look through the photographs, we see many photographs obviously taken by the Paines of themselves and their apartment. Others may have come from the Oldfields, or from Jane Tanner, or Dr. Russell O'Brien, or indeed from the McCann's camera. There is still some doubt about whether the McCann's camera was the Canon or the Olympus examined in Hampshire, or both. But as I shall show in a moment, we do know, at least, that the famous last photo was definitely taken on the Canon, shown clearly on the table in the lounge of the McCann's apartment when the Portuguese police took their first photograph of the scene. One issue that becomes clear as we examine these black and white photos is that some of the photos appear to have been tampered with before being put on the computer discs. Take this one, for example, which is a cropped duplicate of another photo. In other words, someone, presumably either Jerry McCann, Alex Wolfel or Michael Wright, has cropped the photo, taking bits out of it before handing it to the Portuguese police. In addition, there is no black and white version of a cropped playground photograph of Madeleine and Lily together, the one from which we get this picture. This is all that we get in the files, a cropped black and white image side by side with a cropped colour image. So the cropping must have been done on a computer. Something that we saw earlier can be done on the Olympus camera that was handed into the police in Hampshire, apparently by the Fosters. It tends to suggest that those who compiled these images for the Portuguese police just scanned three of them in colour, the three playground pictures, those being the ones they wanted the police to see, whilst scanning the remainder in black and white because they didn't want the police nor the public to be able to have a clear look at those photos. This tells us one simple thing, that these images did not all come straight out of a camera memory card onto a computer disc. Some of them, at least, have been tampered with or manipulated in one way or another before being given to the Portuguese police. And is it possible Jerry McCann, Alex Wolfel and Michael Wright made sure that any inconvenient and embarrassing photographs were never put on those two computer discs in the first place? The Portuguese police received the two discs of photographs on the 9th of May. The very next day, both the McCanns were in the police station answering questions. Kate McCann had her camera, presumably the Canon, with her in the actual police station and was looking at the photographs and making notes on them. Were the Portuguese police duped into thinking that they had got all the relevant photographs from that camera on those two discs the day before? Michael Wright was aged 44 on the day Madeleine was reported missing. He had married Anne Marie, a cousin of Dr. Kate McCann. He was military trained and was said at the time to have been a partner in an IT company. Michael Wright and his wife and the McCanns used to meet up from time to time, mostly at family events. Once in 2006 and once in February 2007. Their families were close and they stayed in each other's houses. The first Christmas after Madeleine was reported missing, the two families spent Christmas together. At a hearing in the long-running McCann v. Amaral libel trial in September 2013, Michael Wright admitted to extensive monitoring of Madeleine McCann discussion forums on the internet. In the court, he referred to extensive notes he had made in green ink to prepare for giving his evidence. The judge in the hearing saw these notes and asked him about them. He said he had written them up the night before in his hotel room. In a written statement to the Portuguese police, Wright said that he caught the plane from Leeds Bradford Airport to Faro on Saturday the 5th of May, initially staying in an apartment in the same complex as the McCanns. He says he returned 6 days later on Friday the 11th of May for a weekend with my family. It seems that one of his main tasks whilst he was in Portugal for those 6 days was to select and maybe manipulate a series of photos in order to produce a computer disc for the Portuguese police on the 9th of May. Meanwhile, the head of public relations at Bell Pottinger, one of the world's biggest PR companies, Alex Wolfall, was working on another similar or parallel project. He was also helping Jerry McCann with photographs in his camera, as this report in the Times on the 6th of October 2007 informs us. The McCanns had photographs of Madeleine on their digital camera, which Mr. Wolfall began transferring to a laptop computer. I said to Kate, let's try to identify pictures where her face is visible. Downloading the images was a very difficult process for them. It was upsetting. Mr. Wolfall transmitted the photographs to the Press Association in London, from where they were distributed to the media. The portfolio included the now famous image of Madeleine wearing a hat on a tennis court. That's the so-called tennis balls photo, by the way. So that article in the Times made things very clear. PR man Alex Wolfall had access to Jerry McCann's camera and memory card and was transferring the photos onto a laptop computer. And of course, if he was transferring them, he could at the same time have been deleting, amending or cropping some of them. So, exactly when was Alex Wolfall transferring these photographs from the McCann's camera to the computer? He maintained that he flew there on Saturday the 5th of May. But in fact, the flight records show that he travelled there on Friday the 4th of May, the very day after Madeleine was reported missing. Why did he have to be there the very next day? A senior member of one of the world's most prestigious PR companies. Madeleine could even have been found during this flight to Portugal. Why did he rush over there? What was his mission exactly? Why did the top man have to go? Why couldn't one of the more junior staff fly out there? And how exactly could any public relations officer search for Madeleine? The Times article told us he was transmitting photographs to the Press Association. And we now know that one of the first photographs he transmitted on Saturday the 5th of May, according to the data, was the controversial tennis balls photo that we looked at earlier. It seems clear also that Wolfall was behind the sending of this photo to the Press Association on Friday the 4th of May as well. That was certainly quick work if he had only just arrived there that day. And it was this very iconic photograph of Madeleine that appeared on the front cover of Kate McCann's book Madeleine 4 years later. It would mean that Wolfall was not only in Praia da Luz on the day after Madeleine was reported missing, but before the day was out, he had met the McCanns, got their camera, and was already sending images from that camera to the Daily Mirror that day. Madeleine in the red dress, and to the Press Association the next day, the tennis balls photo. But here's a strange fact that was picked up by a sharp-eyed poster on the Complete Mystery of Madeleine McCann forum. No one else seems to have picked it up. Here's a new report that appeared in the magazine PR Week, the public relations rag for the public relations officers. This article appeared on the 9th of May issue of PR Week. The head of risk and crisis management of one of the world's biggest PR firms, Alex Wolfall, had been dispatched to Portugal, so this was clearly a significant news item for the journal. But look at the two lines underlined in red. Mark Warner brought in Resonate on a generic brief a week before 3-year-old Madeleine was kidnapped. Now this is very odd. Resonate is simply a subsidiary of Bell Pottinger. There is no explanation at all of why they were sent the week before. What public relations need did Mark Warner have in Praia da Luz the week before Madeleine and her family were there? None that I am aware of or can even think of. And then at the end of the PR Week report we read this. After Madeleine was kidnapped, managing director Michael Froelich referred the firm to his parent company's crisis specialist Alex Wolfall. Froelich and Resonate director Tricia Moon are helping liaise with the British consul in Portugal, the Portuguese police and the Portuguese and UK media. This seems like an astonishing coincidence. Handily available to the powers that be at the very moment Madeleine was allegedly kidnapped were no less than Michael Froelich and Tricia Moon, the managing director and director respectively of Resonate, a subsidiary of probably the UK's number one public relations firm. And already Resonate was liaising with the British consul. It was the British ambassador and consular staff who dramatically and successfully intervened when the Portuguese police, 2 days after Madeleine's reported disappearance, wanted to seize some of the McCanns' clothing. After this intervention, the McCanns washed their clothes, thus preventing the police from subjecting them to forensic analysis. I am going to suggest that there is evidence pointing to Madeleine having died on the Sunday that week. Is it possible that the bosses of Bell Pottinger sent the managing director and director of their subsidiary company Resonate on ahead, as it were, to make some initial inquiries and undertake an early assessment of the situation in advance of their big guns jetting to Pride-o-Luz on the day after Madeleine was reported missing?